disappointment, discouragement, frustration, fatigue, feeling ill or injured. Sometimes an eddy can happen immediately. Loss of a family member is in the hospital, loss of a job. Those types of traumatic, immediate events can suck you into an eddy really quickly. More often than not, however, it's a slow pull into the eddy due to a loss of interest or a loss of purpose in even trying to continue our growth. My eddy occurred, my winter of the soul occurred at the beginning of COVID. Pastor Doug talked about this last week a bit, and the last few weeks continually. COVID hit, we got kicked out of the school, church went to online, you had to, you know, find Doug, you had all week to look at it because it was video, we weren't meeting, we weren't praying, we weren't, it was different. And immediately, I lost interest. I stopped reading. I stopped journaling. I stopped praying. And it was not a pleasant time for me spiritually. So that's just an example where you can find yourself in an eddy. So how do you recognize that you're in an eddy? You need to realize that you're not moving forward. People around you are moving forward. People are having D groups. They're praying. That you look at them and you're like, you've got the spiritual life together, and I'm just sitting here. I feel like I should be moving, but I'm not. So you know that you're in an eddy, and you need to get out. And the only way to get out of an eddy is through hard work. It takes work to stay in the path when you see an eddy coming, because you want to stay out of it. You got to work. Once you're in an eddy, it takes even more work to get back into the main flow of things. You need to put in the effort. You need to notice that you're in an eddy. You need to notice that you have distraction, disappointment, discouragement, fatigue, frustration, and feeling like you don't want to do this anymore. You need to work away from that and get back into the flow. You need to recognize when an eddy's coming, when you're tired. This morning, I woke up frustrated with my wife. I got a call from my daughter who's experiencing her own troubles. And then I get here and I've got some other things that, you know, my life phrase should be, today's not going to go how you expect it to go. Today didn't go how I expected it to go, so I got frustrated. I can see myself getting into an eddy, and I have to recognize that. Close my eyes, pray, get back into the flow of the Spirit. Stay out of the eddies at all cost. How can Christians be deceived while in an eddy? Well, I'm in the water. I'm going to church. I called myself a Christian. I've got Romans 10:9 in my pocket. Confess and believe, and you'll be saved. That's all I need. The Bible calls us to work. We need to work. You need to put in the effort. I'm in the boat. I'm in the river. I must be okay. We've talked a little bit about the armor of God. It was in yesterday's reading. RJ just talked about it a minute ago. The armor of God, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, the belt of truth, the shoes of readiness, the shield of faith, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Okay? How does that relate to an eddy? You have your life vest of righteousness. You have your head protection of salvation. You have your seat in the boat of readiness. You have everything secured in the boat with your straps of truth. You have your boat of faith. And you have the oars of the Spirit of the word of God. If you're just sitting in your boat waiting for God to move you in the Spirit, you're doing it wrong. Amen. Put your hands on the oars, start the work, and get into the flow. That's what they're there for. God gave you the armor. God gave you the boat and everything you need. You need to use it. You need to go to work.
Preach it,
Pastor. Preach it. I will end with Philippians 2, 12 through 13. Therefore, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Please work. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time today. I pray that through me, you have expressed where people might be sitting in an eddy, where they may be stuck in their spiritual growth. Heavenly Father, pull us out of it. Give us the knowledge that you've done the main work for us, but we need to put forth the effort in your Spirit. Heavenly Father, we pray this in your precious name. Amen.
I love whitewater, so that was a great illustration. Thank you, Mark. All right, good morning, everybody. We're about to go into our time of praise and prayer and song. If you haven't come to cross train before, this is a time anybody is welcome to mic. All you have to do is raise your hand, and then you can pray to the Lord, and we will all pray with you. Okay? So last week, we learned about if we don't know what to do, we can always praise and pray. So I was asking the Lord, okay, Lord, what do you want to give us this week? And like he always does, he came in at the right time and said, I want you to tell the people that this can be simple. We're going to spend the next couple of weeks going through prayer and soaking in prayer. But prayer is about relationship with him. And it can be really simple. And it is a wild, wonder-filled ride if you let him do what he calls you to do. Okay? So to keep it really simple, pray, listen, do. Okay? You invite the Holy Spirit to lead you into wherever you're going to go. You listen to his voice, and then you do whatever he says. Okay, I want to tell you a quick story about a girl named Kim who started doing this. She started plowing her field with this kind of pray, listen, do kind of thing. So she wanted to get some picture frames. So she asked the Lord, where do I get picture frames, Lord? He said, go to Goodwill. Okay, she goes to Goodwill. She finds the frames she wants. Okay, I'm done. I can go. The Lord says, not yet. Okay, well, I can go get an outfit. I need to get an outfit for this next speaking engagement. So she gets her outfit and she gets ready. She's going up to the counter and God says, not yet. So she's like, okay, Lord, I've been here an hour. So she goes back and she finds the most beautiful picture frame. And she's like, oh, thank you, Lord. You were trying to bless me. And God says, okay, you're released. You can go check out now. So she goes to the checkout counter. And the guy's a new guy. He doesn't know how to check out. So he calls for the manager, and she's waiting there, and there's a long line of people. And the guy's a little bit, he's scared. And the manager comes up with glowing red hair and bright blue eyes, and she pushes past Kim, pushes her out of the way, and she's like, did you find everything you need? And Kim said, well, actually, I found more than I needed. I found picture frames, and I found an outfit for this speaking engagement. And the lady said, great. And then she said, well, what kind of speaking engagement? And Kim said, well, I teach people about hope. And the lady got really angry and said, well, we need hope in this world because people don't take responsibility for what they do. So Kim's going, okay, Lord, thank you for this opportunity in my life. What do you want me to do with this young woman who is hurting? I can see she's hurting, but what do I do with her, Lord? So the Lord says, okay, Kim, tell your story. And Kim's like, are you sure, Lord? Is this the right place? All these people are mad and they're angry and it's time to go. He's like, tell your story, Kim. So Kim looks at this girl. Her name is Angel. And she says, okay, Angel, here's what I do. I teach people about hope. When I was 12 years old, my dad killed my mom. And then he killed himself. And in my grief, I sunk to my knees and I cried out to Jesus for the first time because I didn't even know who he was. And he became my author of hope. So I go and I share his message to everybody that'll listen. Now Angel starts sobbing. And she says, I've never told anyone this. But when I was 9, my mom killed herself in front of me. So Kim opens up her arms, and there's a counter in between them, and Angel dives across the counter into Kim's arms. And she gets to love on a broken-hearted creature in the name of Jesus for the first time. Okay, it is a wild, wonder-filled ride if you will pray, listen, and do. It can be so simple, but it's going to get so uncomfortable and so beautiful. So as we go into our prayer time today, for the rest of your life, but at least start today, for the rest of today, start just asking the Lord, okay, Lord, I need to get gas. Where do you want me? I need to go shopping. Okay, what do you want me to do? Am I ready? Am I done? And he'll tell you the answers, and it'll be a wild ride, and I look forward to hearing all the stories, because then we're going to have tons and tons and tons of gospel moments. Amen. So let's go into prayer. I'm going to pray over us, and then just raise your hand, and the mic is open. So Father God, I love, you are the great storyteller, and that's one of the things that I love about you, Lord. You invite us into so many stories. So Father, I pray over our people. I pray that you open our hearts, that you allow us the freedom, because through you is truth, and truth leads to freedom. Allow us the freedom to ask you, Father, what's our next step? What do you want us to do? How do you want us to do it? And Lord, give us the courage to walk into it. You love us so much, Lord. Thank you for that. And we love you, and we just want to obey. So help us with that. Hold our hand, because many times it's wild and scary, and we need your nudge. So nudge us gently, tenderly, and firmly. In your name, Jesus. Amen.
Father, I just come to you this morning, Lord, with just thanksgiving for all that you've done, Lord. And you know, my heart's been heavy and just so much on my mind, Lord. But you, I thank you for the story that Brian shared, Lord, because this is what you've been putting on my heart, Lord. And I know for me and many others, Lord, this type of lifestyle starts with slowing down, Lord, and leaving margin in our schedule to pray and listen, because that's hard to do when we're running around and things are crazy and we're moving fast and stuffing kids in the car and just being frustrated. So I pray that you would help me and our family, Lord, and others who want this, Lord, that you would encourage us to slow down and listen and lay things down in our life that aren't going to get us to that, Lord. That we can lay aside good things, Lord, for something better. And I pray that it wouldn't be complicated. I pray that you would just be clear for us and for others, Lord, what it is that you want us to do and not do, so that we can be still enough and slow enough to hear from you, Lord, and just bring hope to a lost and hurting world, Lord. And Lord, while we are praying, Lord, I lift up my dad. I ask that you would breathe life into his lungs, Lord. He's been in the hospital for 22 days now, Lord, and he's ready to come home. I thank you for all that you have taught him during this time, Lord, and his faith has grown, and so has ours, Lord. And he has realized more than ever his need for you and his need for breath, and that is twofold coming from you, Lord, just in the form of the oxygen that we need and he needs, Lord, and just your Holy Spirit breathing with us every single moment. So, Lord, I pray that you would breathe into his lungs, Lord. I pray that you would strengthen his lungs. I pray that, as he's admitted, that mornings are the hardest for him, Lord. I pray that that wouldn't be so this morning, Lord. I pray that you would keep his breathing strong, Lord. I pray that the nurses and doctors would be amazed, Lord. This is your story. And we want to bring you glory through it, Lord. And I pray that you would just fill his lungs and fill his heart with you, Lord. And do what you want to do quickly, Lord, we pray, and get him out of there. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Good morning. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray them, him. He went on to say, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them." From this time, this many disciples turned back and no longer followed him. Father God, I just pray that as the turmoil happens in this life and we are confused maybe on what we should believe and what we shouldn't believe, that our ears would be in tune to you, that our eyes would be looking into your eyes, and that our souls would be empty so that you could fill them with you. Let us not turn away from you, God. Amen.
After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. And there he transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as the light. Just then, there appeared before them Moses and Elijah, talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." Lord, I pray that today we would get a greater appreciation for who you are. Lord, I pray that any earthly diminishment of who we've been told you are would be eradicated from our minds, and we would get an appreciation for the majesty in which you are, for the glowing that you displayed before your disciples that day. You gave them a glimpse into the reality of your Godhood, and also of the glorified humanity of the Son of Man. Lord, you are incredible. Lord, I pray that you would make us all just be amazed and fall in love with you all over again today. That whatever's going on in this world pales in comparison to your majesty. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And Lord, your Father said to listen to you. Lord, I pray that we would listen to you. Lord, I pray that you would speak to us and we would hear. And that, Lord, you would show us more about what it is that you're doing in us and what you want to do through us. Lord, help us to listen. Help us to shut off the noise and listen, that you would tell us what to do. And that, Lord, we would get our marching orders from you. And that, Lord, you would be glorified in our day. Regardless of what else goes on in this world, Lord, may you be glorified in Jesus' name.
Remains the cornerstone. Father, your word says, as a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for a living God. Heavenly Father, my soul thirsts for you. I know our souls thirst for you so many times. We drink of waters that do not satisfy, Lord. Instead of drinking from grace, from your word, from focusing on Jesus, we drink from wells, from anxiety, from anger or fear, from news, politics, social media, whatever have you. We drink from things and we go back to things that do not satisfy, Lord. Lord, help us to deny ourselves. Your word says that we should take up our cross and we should deny ourselves and we should follow you. Help us, Lord. We need your help in this. And satisfy our thirst with you, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Lord, you said, your word says that it is powerful enough to equip us for all good works, any good work that we do. And you've put on my heart to do a good work, and I just ask for a huge blessing in that work, that it would not return void, as your word does not return void, but that it would be more than I can imagine, and that it would magnify you. In Jesus' name.
Lord, I thank you. I know you know that my journey has not been the easiest. I know it has been a long time coming, and it has not been easy for me to find a home. I thank you so much for staying with me throughout the years, staying in my fight, and reminding me through so many different people of your love and your righteousness. I thank you for giving me such close friends who always want to remind me that, specifically of Caitlin, giving her your love and showing it through her, through so many people, and letting her invite me to her home and giving such a positive environment. And Lord, I pray to Cross Train, I pray to Pastor Doug and everyone here that we can continue this positive environment, that we can continue to train and show people the love that you have to give to everyone, and that we may show it to the world and to people like me who are still fighting, who know your love and can see it. I pray that you continue this, and I pray that you let us out of our own heads, that we may stop being riddled down by it, and we can go into your head, into your heart, and we can see your goodness and love, and we can show that to the world. Show people your love. I know it's not an easy environment, but I know that you have the power to show it through everyone. Free us from the enemy. Help us fight the good battle. Show us the love that we all need to hear. In Jesus' name.
Dear Lord, I ask nothing of myself for myself. You gave me air to breathe this morning, gave me two legs to stand on, ears to hear your word, and a voice to spread your word. Watch over Louisiana as Hurricane Ida hits land shore right now. Protect them. Wrap your loving arms around this congregation. Show them your love as they show our love to you. Protect them and comfort them. This we ask in our Lord Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
The whole Check. Okay. We're figuring it out. We'll do this. Okay, so we're going to sing a new song for you guys. It's called Grace is on Our Side. As I was like meditating through the lyrics, it's a song of rejoicing. You'll get that vibe in a minute. But it's sometimes I feel like we just need the reminder that at the end of the day, the Lord is on our side. After what he did on the cross, no matter what our days look like, no matter what season of life we're in, if at the end of the day, all we can say is we know he is with us and he is for us, then we're good. We're going to be okay. So we're going to sing the chorus for you, and then we'll go into the rest of the song. Sing along if you can. It's pretty catchy, so...
Yeah.
just rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus rose in my place.
Amen, amen, amen. Would you pray with me? Father, we stand before you because the Son has set us free. And when the Son has set us free, we are free indeed. Lord, I pray that we would never take for granted what it took to make that happen. That on a criminal's cross, you were crucified, dead, buried, but you did not stay there. You rose again and punched a hole through this world. You have pierced this present darkness with the light of your glory and grace. I thank you that right now as we gather, you are in our presence. And as we pray, your attention is on this place as if nothing else in all of your creation mattered to you. May we never take for granted the privilege of being in relationship and conversation with the God who not only is the God of the universe, but the one who came, lived, died, and rose again to make that possible. It is for the glory and the fame of the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we pray these things. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Please remain standing for the reading of the word.
When Ahab got home, he told Jezebel everything Elijah had done, including the way he had killed all the prophets of Baal. So Jezebel sent this message to Elijah: "May the gods strike me and even kill me if by this time tomorrow I have not killed you just as you killed them." Elijah was afraid and fled for his life. He went to Beersheba, a town in Judah, and he left his servant there. Then he went on alone into the wilderness, traveling all day. He sat down under a solitary broom tree and prayed that he might die. "I have had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life, for I am no better than my ancestors who have already died." Then he laid down and slept under the broom tree. But as he was sleeping, an angel touched him and told him, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there beside his head was some bread baked on hot stones and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and laid down again. Then the angel of the Lord came again and touched him and said, "Get up and eat some more, or the journey ahead will be too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank, and the food gave him enough strength to travel 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Sinai, the mountain of God. There he came to a cave where he spent the night. But the Lord said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?"
This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. Grab your Bibles and find 1 Kings chapter 18. While you're doing that, I just want to remind you of, I want to tell you about something that Charles Haddon Spurgeon once said. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, for those of you that don't know, was a 19th century, means he lived in the 1800s, preacher. He said this about the church: "Believe me, if a church does not pray, it is dead. Instead of putting united prayer last, put it first. Everything will hinge upon the power of prayer in the church." Here's what's interesting about Spurgeon.
He is known for being called the Prince of Preachers. Guys, he was a man who in his early 20s became the first ever celebrity pastor. Like, people would literally travel from the U.S. to London in the 1800s, which was not necessarily a safe journey and certainly not a short journey. They would travel to London to hear him preach. He eventually had congregation sizes of over 10,000 people. And so he is known. I mean, his commentaries on the Word of God are legendary. His theology was spot on. I mean, he was a fallen man like the rest of us, but he was used by God in mighty ways. It's why you hear pastors from all denominations quote Charles Spurgeon, because there was just some special anointing on this man. But here's what's interesting. He talked more about prayer than anything else he talked about. This man who was known as the Prince of Preachers, who was all about God's word, talked about prayer all the time. He was so into prayer and so into the power of prayer that not only did he have people praying for the service, before the service, as we do, under the wooden platform on which he preached from, there were a group of people huddled up in this cold, dark place praying for what he was preaching above them, and he would always say, that's where the power comes from. It wasn't from him, and it wasn't even, he was saying, from the word. It was from the effectual work of the word through the prayer of people. And so, one of the first quotes I ever heard about Spurgeon, this is when I first went into ministry about 15 years ago, when God first called us into full-time ministry, he said this, prayer moves the arm that moves the world. Prayer moves the arm that moves the world. Here's what that means. That means that somehow in God's sovereignty, our prayers partner with his power. And so if that's true, we ought to be a lot more tapped in to that kind of power. It's part of what led us to, if you've been here with us for any length of time, you've seen, even just today, you've seen how we reorganized our Sunday gathering to make prayer not the last thing, but the first thing. But that didn't even start when we started regathering in the summer of 2020 when we found a place to gather in June. It didn't even start, if you remember and you were with us back in the Sierra Verde Elementary School days, when in March of 2019, we rearranged our service, including our start time. It used to start at 9:30, started at 10, so that we could move prayer. We had pre-service prayer going for several years, but it was in this classroom off to the side, and we decided we wanted to move it out into the main part of our church gathering. Not like we're doing it now, but it was part of what God was unfolding in us as we wanted to become a people, not just a church that prayed, but a people of prayer. See, here was my problem. We have put prayer, we've had a prayer ministry going on here for years and years, right? Even before Brian Tootin was the deacon over it. We had prayer nights on Wednesday nights. We'd meet in people's homes. We would make prayer a big part of our small group ministry at the time. But I'll be honest, it was always a very frustrating thing, because if there was the least attended, the least interactive part of our gatherings in any setting, Sundays or weekdays, it was the prayer part. Like we would have a prayer gathering every Wednesday or once a month on the first Wednesday of every month. It was lightly attended, to say the least. And one of the things that struck me, and this was not in 2020 or 2019, it was back in 2018, was part of our problem was what we're saying on Sundays. Prayer is important. And what we're doing on Sundays didn't match. Because we'd say prayer was important, but prior to 2019, when we rearranged our service, if you added up in our 90-minute service, if you added up the amount of time we spent praying, it was probably 10 minutes. So what we were saying was prayer is really important. What we were doing was praying about like the average church does for maybe 10 minutes during the service time. At all the times that you know normal churches, even ours, pray. Before the message, after the message, those kinds of things. So the Lord has been unfolding in us this desire to not just be a church that prays, but a people who pray. And it's what you've seen in the first hour of our service is just an overflow of that. But there's still work to be done here, guys. What we want to try to figure out as a people is now, how do we take what we're experiencing here on Sundays in our gathering and move it out from here, individually and collectively? Because there are some things that your prayer life says about you or tells you a little bit about in just in your corporate beliefs and also in your individual beliefs. Here are a few of them. Do you believe God is there? Like, do you really believe God is there? If you do, do you believe God cares? Right? Do you believe that Jesus wants real relationship with you? Not just in the sense of Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. I don't mean that. I mean, he wants to have ongoing conversation with you. And do you really believe he calls you friend? Because that's what he calls you. If you're his, he says, you are no longer slaves. Now I call you friend. John 15:15. And friends talk, right? Friends talk together. What we came to the conviction of is what Spurgeon said in this. You're going to hear several Spurgeon quotes today. If we shall never see much change for the better in our churches in general till the prayer meeting occupies a higher place in the esteem of the Christian. And I would say that prayer meeting for us right now, we're going to have a praise and worship night here on Friday the 10th of September. There will be prayer involved in that. We're hoping to start doing things like that more regularly, even in this space, but even in our D groups, in our other gathered times, and individually, do we put prayer first? Because as Spurgeon said, a prayerful church is a powerful church. Why? Well, I've spent some time as we were going through the Summer in the Sola series. We started out with the Imago Dei, and I talked about how did God bring people to life? How did he created Adam? How did he bring the big ball of mud to life? He breathed into him. I love how Spurgeon put it. Prayer is the breath of God in man returning back to whom it came. So that's where we're breathing the Spirit of God in. We're breathing him in as we're in the Word, as we're in fellowship, as we're meditating on him and who he is. And then in our conversation back to him, we're just breathing out what he's already placed into us. And that's what prayer is. So we're starting this series called The Secret to Prayer. And one of the things about this series that we're starting in is, one, I've had to fight the urge all week to tell you everything there is to say about prayer. Because we've taught on prayer here before, but usually it's like maybe 1 week on prayer here when it came up in the toolkit series. Or if it came up in Daniel, we would talk about how prayer worked when we were going through the book of Daniel. But we've never taken the time to go, hey, we need to spend if we really want to be a people of prayer, we need it to just overwhelm our conversation as a family, not just on Sundays, but throughout the week. So as Brian Tootin and I were talking and praying even a little bit throughout the summer, and we were thinking, okay, how does this work? Well, one is, it can't just be a one or two Sunday thing. So we're going to spend the next, 7 Sundays and retreat talking about the different aspects of prayer. So I'm not covering everything there is to cover about prayer, because we're going to spend a bunch of time talking about prayer. And towards the end of the series, Brian Tootin's going to share one of the messages. In a couple weeks, Lord willing, the author of this book that we have out in the lobby, where I got the title for the series, The Secret to Prayer, the author of this book is going to come and preach that Sunday on the 12th, Lord willing. So be praying for that, because you guys are going to love him. Hopefully not too much, but you're going to love him. Really, really, really dynamic young theologian, I guess I would say. And he's not that young, but younger than you would expect an author and professor and guy with a doctorate to be. But we have these books available out in the lobby at the table. We're not going to go through. I'm not going to ever open this book up on a Sunday that I know of. That's not what we're here for. We're here for this book. We still have the daily readings that are going to go along with each week's topic and carry on the conversation with what you hear today. But what this book is available for is to help flavor your conversation. Whether that's your conversation with your family, your spouse, or just with you and the Lord. To just give you a different perspective on prayer. So we're talking about the secret to prayer. Today, the topic that we're talking about is the secret to the power of prayer. So before we go any further, I just want to ask you our first talking points question. I'm going to have you just turn to your neighbor quickly and answer this. How is your prayer life? Here are your talking points are on the back of your, are in your insert now, in your bulletin. They're on the back of your insert if you needed one. I don't know if we have any left or not, but somebody I'm sure could get you one. But here's the question. How is your prayer life? Here are your only three choices. I know there's probably others. These are the three I'm giving you. Strong, struggling, or stagnant. Guys, this is a safe place. One of the things we talked about in our foundations class on Tuesday and on Tuesday morning and Tuesday night, and I think I mentioned even last week in the message, is guys, people who are struggling with their walk feel like the last place they can come for that struggle is the church. And that needs to, we're going to kill that thing now. Right? So if you never pray, which one of these three are you? Stagnant. So here's what I want you to do right now. I want you to risk being honest. Just turn to your neighbor. I'm going to give you like 5 seconds. Turn to your neighbor and say out loud which of those three you are. Go. Okay. So I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand and say how many of you are struggling and how many of you are stagnant and how many of you are strong in your prayer life. But here's what I do want to ask. What kind of criteria are you using to measure that? So you just gave an answer to somebody, hopefully. What kind of criteria did you mentally use to give that answer? I'm asking. Raise your hand. Sean. Okay, so what and thank you for sharing where you're at, but you don't have to share where you're at if you don't want to share with the whole body that you're struggling in prayer. But you can. It's a safe place. Thank you, Sean, for modeling that. It's a safe place. But what he said was because the barometer for that for Sean was the amount of praying he does. Good. Keep going. Tina. Okay, so in case you couldn't hear Tina, she said the struggle might be that you're actually praying. The amount is okay, but you don't actually have faith in. Or remember, we talked about our part of faith is we don't actually believe what we're praying is going to happen. Right? Good, awesome, because that's actually a biblical struggle of faith.
Is
Scott,
is the prayer self-based?
Is the prayer self-based? Good. So your barometer for how you're doing in prayer is also about not just how much you're praying and how much you believe in what you're praying, is it like the power behind what you're praying, but also the things you're praying for. And you can see there's, and we could probably go on for a long time, but you can see that there's a lot of things that we think about. And guys, this is not a message about just pray more, right? This is a series over the next couple of months that will hopefully just encourage us to pray more because we're doing it. Because we're like, man, I can't not pray anymore. Because we've all heard about the obstacles to prayer, like being too busy, like being distracted, like not, you know, all those things, right? I'm not here to tell you about those obstacles. I'm not even going to talk about those obstacles next week. What we want to talk about is just what prayer is and why it even matters. And the Holy Spirit will take that and turn you into a person of prayer if you will let Him. If you will let Him. So today's training thought is, what is the secret to a power-filled prayer night? But guys, we're not going to sit here and talk about, prayer life. It's not looking at here's a prayer list, here's different styles of praying. It's none of that. It really is, here are these three things that we're going to see from Elijah today. The secret to a power-filled prayer, just as our launching out of the gate in this series on prayer, is the first is we have to call in the name of Jesus. The second is it's crying out to Him. It's having a heart that is vulnerable, right? And the third is creating space. And I love how, without even knowing it, everybody who has shared so far today, from RJ, who shared about the D groups, to Mark, to like some of the stuff the music team was talking about, and what was even prayed during the prayer time, it was, are we making space for a conversation with the Lord? And that was what Tina, that's exactly what, that's part of what you were praying. It's like, just in the busyness of life, do I even make space? So we're going to finish there, Lord willing. So let's look at our first training truth, calling on his name. So what is the secret to living this power-filled prayer life? The first is calling on his name. So open up your Bibles. I told you to do that already. I didn't. To 1 Kings chapter 9, or chapter 18. And I'm going to start in verse 20 with our first point. Now, guys, this is a familiar story. We've taught on this a lot. In fact, Jeff, when he taught 2 weeks ago, talked about this part of the story. So, and it's probably the most, this scene of calling fire down on Mount Carmel is probably the most well-known scene in Elijah's life, and I'm going to try and go through it as fast as I can, because frankly, what we're going to find out is it's not even like in the top three of the most important moments of Elijah's life. Like his biggest moment, I mean, you would think fire falling down and destroying, like, when he prays for it, would be like, this would be his number one thing. It was not Elijah's number one moment with God, and that's part of what we're going to see. However, how he prays here is very important. So, in verse 20 of chapter 18 of 1 Kings, it says this. This is the word of the Lord. So Ahab sent to all the people of Israel and gathered the prophets together at Mount Carmel. And Elijah, so Ahab was the king at the time. He was clueless, we'll see that, but he was the king. Elijah came near to all the people and said, "How long will you go limping between two different opinions? If the Lord, Yahweh, is God, follow him. If Baal, then follow him." And the people did not answer him a word. Guys, do you remember? This is the message from last week, so I'm not going to belabor it. There are only two kingdoms. There is the kingdom of God, and this is what Elijah is saying. If God is God, get busy about his kingdom. If Baal, who is one of the gods of this world, is God, then get busy about him. But stop this back and forth. So he keeps going. "Let two bulls be given to us, and let them choose one bull for themselves and cut it into pieces and lay it on the wood. But put no fire under it." So this is how they would sacrifice offerings, including God's people would, and the Baal worshippers would as well. And I will prepare the other bull and lay it in the wood and put no fire under it. And I will call, and you will call upon the name of your God, and I will call upon the name of the Lord, Yahweh. And the God who answers by fire, he is God. And all the people said, "Sounds good to me. That's well spoken." Right? Here's the thing. The people that he called to the mountain were really interested in what was about to happen, but they were solely spectators. They had no interest in glorifying God or seeing God show up. They just wanted to see what was about to happen next. They wanted some entertainment. Now, guys, this is not just a scene that happened around 1,000 or 900 or so BC, this is relevant today. So many people sitting in churches today, right now, I mean like literally today, are just looking for the show. They have no interest in the glory of God, right? And a lot of them don't even know it. But they're like, sounds good to us. Guys, here's a quick aside. The God who answers by fire, he is God. Here's the reality. We know this from the end of the story. Our God will answer again by fire. Right, he isn't going to flood the world again. He's going to burn the whole thing up and make the new heaven and the new earth. Our God is going to answer again by fire. And we cannot forget that that is ultimately how he's going to prove himself. But you got to remember something else. What did Jesus say when he was talking to the people that were following him? In Luke 18, he says, "But when the Son of Man comes again to answer the second time with fire, is he going to find faith on the earth?" I mean, I was like, he was under some sort of such holy discouragement at the time. God, Jesus was, that he was like, "I'm not sure when I come back, I'm going to find anybody here that believes in me." Now, I know he knew different, but he was like, "Guys, come on, get with the program. Church at Laodicea, don't be lukewarm. I'm going to spit you out of my mouth if you stay lukewarm." Let's keep going. Then Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, "Choose for yourselves one bull and prepare it first for your many, and call upon the name of your God, but put no fire under it." And then he says, look at verse 26. "And they took the bull that it was given to them, and they prepared it, and called upon the name of Baal from morning until noon, saying, 'O Baal, answer us!' But there was no voice, and no one answered, and they limped around the altar that they looked around the altar that they had made. Guys, Spurgeon said this about not just who we pray to, but back to Tina's point, the belief in our prayer. He said, there is no better thermometer to your spiritual temperature than the measure of your intensity when you pray. Now I share that here because I want to say they are going to go on and from the outside look very intense. So let's keep going. At noon, Elijah mocked them, saying, "Cry aloud." So he's like, "Cry louder, for he is a god. Either he is musing," so he's just thinking deeply about stuff, "or he's relieving himself, going to the bathroom, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is asleep and he must be awakened." So probably not in great example about how to engage the culture. Elijah is mocking their false belief, like in their face. And they cried out louder, and they cut themselves, and until blood gushed out of them. Verse 29, and midday passed, they raved on until the time of the offering of oblation, which just means the time of the evening offering. But there was no voice. No one answered them. No one paid attention. Why didn't anyone pay attention? Because there was no one listening. Because of who they were praying to. So the amount of praying, the intensity of your praying, no offense, Charles Spurgeon, and I know what he meant in the context of that quote I shared, but matters not if you're not praying to the right one, right? Thus, calling on his name, because they're doing a lot of screaming. They cried aloud, they raved on, no one's answering. So it's not about calling out, just calling out. It's about calling out on the name of the Lord, because look at what happens next. Verse 30, then Elijah said to the people, "Come near me." It's his way of going, "Hey guys, huddle up. Huddle up, because we're about to see something really important here." So he says, "Hey everybody, huddle up." And all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that had been thrown down. I'm going to summarize the next few verses. So he creates the altar with the 12 stones as the picture of Israel, right? He has them put the calf on the altar. He has them dig a trench that will hold about 4 gallons of water around the thing. He has them fill it up with water jugs 3 times, which, oh, by the way, this whole thing is set up perfectly. Elijah, like the Lord, and here's why. Because here's how this moment comes in Elijah's life. It's not like Elijah was just walking along and all of a sudden he went, "Hey, this seems like a good idea. I think I'll call fire down." He's been in constant conversation in the context of 1 Kings 18, i.e. chapters 16 and 17. If you read those chapters, you'll see that Elijah's in this conversation with the Lord. And that is what's led him to this place. And so now he's going, okay, The Baals, Mount Carmel, I was there when I was blessed to get to go to Israel back in 2017. Mount Carmel is where they worshipped Baal. And they would have moments like this, hoping that something miraculous would show up. Oh, by the way, there was also a massive drought going on caused by Elijah, who prayed for no rain 3.5 years before this. So he is throwing it in their face saying, "Hey, I know you guys don't have any water, but what you do have, come dump it right here." He isn't just making the wood wet so that it proves the point that God can even light on fire wet wood, right? Like we got to get past like that sort of like small-mindedness of God of, well, you know, he was just trying to show them, look, my God can even ignite wet wood. No, he was saying, hey, he was just making a point to them even in the midst of their drought. So before he prays, here's another Spurgeon quote. Remember, this is the man that was called the Prince of Preachers. That man said, "I would rather teach one man to pray than 10 men to preach." The Prince of Preachers, who probably did more to shape the teaching of God's word in his time than anybody else in human history, said, "I would rather teach one dude to pray than 10 to teach God's word." That's how powerful he believed prayer was. Okay, so let's pick it up and see how Elijah prays. Verse 36. And at the time of the offering of the oblation, Elijah the prophet came near and said, he doesn't just say, you know, whatever it was the Baal worshippers were saying. He says, "O Lord," as if to make it specific, "God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel," which is Jacob, Let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Right? He is saying, you're the one that led me here, and it is in your name. Oh, answer me, O Lord, O Yahweh. That's why it's in all caps. Answer me that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offering and the wood and the stones and the dust and everything else. The water, all of it, it didn't matter. It was gone. Licked up all the water. Verse 39, and when the people saw it, they said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. And there was great national revival. No. See, here's the problem. Those people were convinced. They weren't converted. They're like, man, we just saw this amazing thing happen. But there was no heart change. Guys, it's no different, and I don't want to step on toes here, but I'm telling you, it's no different than the people that want to come to a church service, including the people that come to this church service, who want an emotional experience. They were moved by the emotion of the moment. Now, guys, if you've been here very long, you know I'm not anti-emotion. Right? And if you haven't been very long, let the laughter prove the point. Right, I am not anti-emotion. What I'm saying is if what we need is some emotional worship experience to get us through the next day, here's the great, and I'm even all for emotional worship experiences. I am. I mean, I love it when the music moves me at that part of, or your prayer time moves me to tears. I love that. But if that's what I'm counting on to get me through the next day, you and I both know that doesn't make it through the afternoon. It just doesn't. And so if we're just moving from emotional experience to emotional experience, guess where we find ourselves? In the Eddie people. Right? We have got, our faith is about so much more than that. So these people, look how moved by emotion they are. Oh, by the way, verse 40, they help Elijah slaughter 450 people. That is pretty moved by emotion. And yet, if you read the rest of that chapters, they are gone after this moment. It didn't last through the afternoon. They didn't get the blood off their hands before their emotional experience with God was gone. And man, that is a scary place for us. Groupthink is not a good place to be. One more Spurgeon quote before we have our next talking point. He says this, whether we like it or not, asking is the rule of the kingdom. If you may have everything by asking in his name, remember, he's just quoting Jesus. If you ask in my name, it will be given to you. And we'll come back to this thought in a few minutes. I beg you to see how absolutely vital prayer is. Guys, especially for those of you that are staunch sovereignty of God people, God knows everything, and he does. God has power over everything, and he does. So why does my prayer matter? Because prayer moves the arm that moves the world. The same God that ordained the outcome, the event, is also the God who ordains the means, and that's you and I getting on our knees and praying. And ultimately, what Spurgeon is saying here is, guys, you got to ask. Right? Because, and there's reasons you need to ask. And we'll talk about those as we go today and throughout this series. But we got to ask. But we got to ask rightly. We got to ask in his name. So here's the talking point question. It's the only one I'm going to give you even a couple minutes to talk about. It says this. We are called to pray in Jesus' name. But what does it sound like to invoke the name of Jesus in our prayers? And why does that matter? What does it sound like? So I'm just going to give you one minute. What does it sound like to invoke the name of Jesus in your prayers? Go. Okay. So what does it sound like to invoke the name of Jesus? Just real quick answers, please, because I know we're running short on time. So real, what does it sound like to invoke the name of Jesus? Exalt his name on high. So in your prayer, even, you can exalt his name, like while you're praying. Good. What else?
Gratefulness.
Good.
Quote the word because he is the word.
Quote the word because he is the word. Awesome. So good. Yes.
Your will, not my will,
be done. Awesome. Like, quote Christ, even. Guys, I mean, there's a reason we say, like, in Jesus' name, amen. It isn't just a nice, it's not like a comma with a nice ending to the sentence or to the paragraph of your prayer. It really is invoking the name of Christ. Do you remember how they healed the lame beggar when they're walking into the temple? They're like, I have nothing to give you, but here's what I do have. I have the name of Jesus. Now get up. Right, there is power in his name. In the name of Jesus, demons flee. Not in your name, not in my name, not in Cross Train. In the name of Jesus, demons flee. Like, there is power in the name, but it doesn't have to be just saying his name. It can also be just acknowledging his name as powerful. Like, that's a huge part of our prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Right? Do we, guys, this is why, and again, I might step on some toes here. This is why I'm not a huge fan of the, hey, daddy, how are you prayers. Right? I get that we can cry out to him, Abba, Father. I get that he is our Father. I get that we should come to him as a dad with his arms open wide, and he's never a dad like this. But doing somewhere between that reality and diminishing his name by just saying, hey, daddy. Yeah, not. No, he is Yahweh. He is Lord. They won't even speak his name. Right? That's how powerful it is. So we do need to be careful of that, I think. Let me go back to the passage. So look at verse 41. I'm just going to summarize the end of this chapter. So I mentioned a minute ago that 3.5 years prior to this scene, Elijah had prayed for no rain. Now he goes and he starts praying for rain right after the scene on Mount Carmel. He prays 7 times earnestly. And the word earnestly there in the Hebrew means, like, I'm not even going to do it right now because I throw my back out. He squats down, like gets down, squats down, and puts his head between his legs and is just praying, like, Lord, bring rain. Lord, bring rain. Gets up, no rain. He does that 7 times, and then it starts to pour down rain. And then he outruns Ahab 17 miles to Jezreel. Right now, we're going to pick it up in our second point and look at the secret power of the secret to living a power-filled life is calling on his name, but it's also crying out to him. So now he has seen God bring fire down on Mount Carmel. He has seen God, while he's praying, bring rain after 3.5 years. Now look at what happens to poor Elijah next. Here's, before we get to the second scene of Elijah, do you remember what James says about Elijah? Just to show you that what we're about to read is way more important in Elijah's life than even the Mount Carmel scene. He says what? He was a man with a nature just like us, right? He was a man just like us. And then he says, and when he prayed for rain, it rained. I'm like, wait a minute, wouldn't you say, like, and when he prayed for fire to fall on Mount Carmel and slaughter 450 of the enemy, that ought to be like the defining moment of the prophet? Apparently James didn't think so. Right? And then if you read on in James, even the way James puts that in there, he's really talking more about Elijah's weakness than his strength. So let's pick it up in verse 1 of chapter 19. These are the passages that Emma read before we started. It says, Ahab told Jezebel, so that was his wife, all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets of the sword. And she was, by the way, a huge fan of those prophets. When Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah and said, so may the gods do to me and more also if I do not make your life as one of them by this time tomorrow. So she's threatening his life. She's saying, may the gods kill me if I don't get to you by tomorrow. It tells you a little bit about the state of the kingship in God's people, doesn't it? That Ahab's letting his nutso wife run things. And that was not a gender slight. This particular woman happened to be nutso. Okay. Verse 3. Then he was afraid, and he arose and ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree, and he asked that he might die, saying, "It is enough now, Lord. Take my life, for I am no better than the fathers." Because have you ever been there? I mean, have you ever been to that place? Like, even after you've seen, sometimes especially after you've seen God show up in just really miraculous ways, and all of a sudden you're like, one bit of news, because this is my reality almost every Sunday afternoon. And most of the bad news I'm getting is the stuff I'm feeding to myself. Man, I talked too long. Man, I was too harsh. Man, I was this. Man, I was that. Man, I'm ready to retire. I'm ready to resign my pastorate. Just saw God do amazing things. Just had an amazing time with my church family. And just like that, it can turn on us. So I'm not here to judge Elijah. I'm here to say, man, brother, I get it. And sometimes God puts us in those places so that we will cry out to him, so that we'll remember that he is the only one we can cry out to. Spurgeon said it this way: the best style of prayer is that which cannot be called anything else but a cry. Guys, you want to know what it looks like to live a power-filled prayer life? A lot of tears. A lot of tears. I'm not a crier. You will be. I didn't mean me, but thank you. I'm saying, many of you, I don't cry. Guys, I am praying right now. Lord, I want to pray right now for those of us in this room or those that are online listening that say that we're just not emotional, we're just not criers. I want to pray that not today, but today and through this series, that you would use this to soften our hearts. If Jesus wept, if David wept, let us weep in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's keep going. Because if we turn to God, he will turn to us. Now look what happens. It says in verse 5, second half of verse 5, "And behold, an angel touched him and said to him, 'Arise and eat.'" So God graciously, as God often does, always does, he provides him exactly what he needs in the moment. It says, "He looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked with hot stones and a jar of water, and he ate and drank, and he lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came to him again a second time and touched him and said, 'Arise and eat, for this journey is too great for you.'" Man, isn't that true about our lives? And so God graciously comes, and he feeds us, and he cares for us, and he picks up one of the lines in the songs we sang. He picks our weary head up. Right, and this is what he's doing for Elijah. He says, "He arose and he ate and he drank and he went in that strength of food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God." Verse 9, then he came to a cave and he lodged in it, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Guys, our prayer life is probably the greatest barometer, the greatest thermometer, the greatest measure of whether or not we trust God or not. Nothing else we do. Guys, you know my soapbox, reading and responding to God's word every day. I'm here to tell you that how much you pray, when you pray, the kind of things you pray about, all those things we talked about at the beginning about how we measure our prayer lives, it says more about your heart for God than any time you spend in God's word. Right? Study after study will show you that if when they survey Christians, that when they say, "What is the spiritual discipline you struggle with the most?" It's prayer. Study after study shows that when they survey churches, when they say, "What do you think the weakest part of your church is?" It's prayer. Why? Because prayer, frankly, is hard. It is work. I loved where Mark took us with the Eddie moment, because it is grabbing a hold of the oars and rowing your boat back out into the flow of water. That is prayer. And the stream, the river, is the word. Right? But we have got to be willing to do the work. And that brings us to our last point. So how do we live this power-filled prayer life? Calling on his name, crying out to him, and then creating space for his presence. So the question is, where's the power? This is what God is going to show Elijah next. This is what God is trying. Here's what he's trying to tell Elijah. So what happened to Elijah? How did he get from everybody huddle up? We're going to watch God do something amazing. I'm going to pray 7 times. We're going to see God bring rain to this person who hears a word and he runs. How did he get there? Here's how he got there. He got his eyes focused on the wrong thing. Because when he was calling fire down on Mount Carmel, when he was praying for rain, who was he praying the glory for? God. The Lord who answers by fire, he is God. He was praying God's glory for God's kingdom. He gets to this point in his life and everything is me, me, me. It is enough now, Lord, take my life. I am the only one left. Guys, I'll leave you a little secret backstory. He knew he wasn't the only one left. Because in chapters 16, 17, and 18, he talks about the other prophets of God that are still in hiding. Right? So he is good, but he's gotten to this place where he believes he's the only one. He's gotten his eyes on the wrong thing. He's got, instead of looking at bringing God glory, he's looking at his own ministry and going, I'm a failure. These people that were all on fire for the Lord grew cold overnight, and here we go again. Right? And he is caught up in his own self. And what God wants to show him is it's not just that the power is in the thing you're praying for. The power isn't just when the fire falls. The power is in the act of praying. What God wants to show Elijah, what God wants to show you and me, is that it is in the act of praying that we are most in tune with him. How? Because it's in the act of praying that we are in the biggest moment of need. Like acknowledging our own inability is what I mean by need. That you may not even be praying for something you personally need. You might be praying for the people in Afghanistan. But what you realize in that moment is that I personally can do nothing for those people or their families who died over there. Right? And in that moment, I am completely dependent on the Lord. Lord, you have to because I can't. Right? That is the dialogue of prayer. Lord, you have to because I can't. But the problem is, back to Scott's point, is too often we pray such, even when we do pray, we pray such selfish and minor prayers. Now, don't get me wrong, and please do not hear this. Does God want us to be praying for healing for people that we love? Absolutely. When I found out my dad was diagnosed with Parkinson's and Alzheimer's 5 years ago, I started praying right away, Lord, slow it down. Lord, heal him. We had other people doing that. But I also started praying a small thing, healing for my father. I get that it's not a small thing. In the grand scheme of the universe, it's a small thing. I started praying that small thing with a kingdom mindset. Instead of just praying, Lord, heal my father, I prayed, Lord, heal my father, and while he's struggling, heal him spiritually. And God did. I loved how Tina prayed for her dad. She's like, Dad, heal my dad. But the growth I've seen in my dad spiritually in his 22 days in the hospital. Right? What God is trying to show us now is it is not just in the thing you're praying for, or it is in the act of praying that we have power. Because it's when we get to our point of dying to self. Guys, prayer is like where self goes to die. And frankly, I'll just speak for me. I could use a lot more self-death in my life. So that's part of our motivation to be better prayers. Okay, so look at verse 10. And he said, I've been very zealous for the Lord. He's like, Lord, I've been doing all this great stuff for you, the God of hosts. For the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant and thrown down your altars and killed your prophets with the sword, and I am the only one left, and they seek my life to take it away. That is not true, and Elijah knows it, but he's now convinced himself it's true. And it says, so, and then God says this to him, go out and stand on the mountain before me. And the Lord passed by in the great and strong wind of the mountain and broke up the pieces of the rocks before the Lord. That's some serious wind. But the Lord was not in the wind. And then the wind, the earthquake, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. There's no really good English way to translate that, the Hebrew there. It actually means something to the effect of a silence that could be heard. Do you hear that? Do you hear the AC unit going? Have you ever been anywhere that is just silent? It's hard in our world, right? I mean, even when you go out camping, there's airplane noise sometimes. If you've ever been somewhere where it is really silent, like when we've gone into the Cave of the Domes down on our Grand Canyon hike, and you go way back in there, and there is literally no light, like you turn off everybody's flashlights, and you get everybody to actually be quiet, which takes an act of God for some reason. And if you've been there, you know. And you go, okay, just take your hand and put it into, and you will actually hit yourself in the face because there's no depth perception. But here's the other part. It is so quiet that you can actually, like, it starts to press in on, I mean, I'm telling you, you can feel it with your eardrums. It's weird, right? That's what he's saying. He's saying, he showed him all this stuff and he's like, I'm not in the big moment. Doesn't mean he can't be. But what he's trying to show Elijah, he's trying to say, Elijah, here's the problem. When you were looking for the big moment and I showed up, you started thinking that was about you too. It's about me. And he's like, I'm not in these big moments. I'm in the nothing moment. I'm in the space that you make just to be you and me. Just to hear that still, small voice. Guys, I do want to say, we'll talk about this more, it's not an audible hearing in the sense of the Lord is telling you, like the word of the Lord, he's not giving you a new word, but it is the Holy Spirit impressing upon your heart, this is what God wants for you in this moment. And that's the conversation you're having, right? When you make that time. Did God give Elijah what he needed? Did he give him what he asked for? No, he asked to die. Did he give him what he needed? Yeah. You know what he said? He said, here's some food, here's some water, get back in the fight. I'm going to show you what's true, get back in there. You just keep doing what I've told you to do. As we go into this time of response, and the music team comes up, and they're going to start passing the trays around like we did last week, and then I'll come back up and lead us in the partaking of the elements. Guys, I want to ask you this question. At the end of verse 13, God says this to Elijah. So he shows up, he says, Elijah hears this still small voice, and then that voice whispers to his spirit, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? What are you doing here, Elijah? Now guys, I don't believe for a minute, because I know the heart of our God, and so do you, that he was not ridiculing Elijah. He was not looking at Elijah going, what are you doing here? Like, seriously? But if some of us feel like that's how God talks to us. Here's how I think he was saying it. It's not clear in the Hebrew how he was saying it, but here's how I think he was saying it. What are you doing here? Like, what are you doing here? Have you forgotten who I am? Have you forgotten how much, and even more than who I am and what you've seen me do, have you forgotten how much I care about you? Right, so as you respond to this time, and we get ready to take communion, and you hear God's word read over you, I want to ask you a question. Is God near to you? Do you believe that he wants relationship with you? Do you believe he longs to hear from you? What are you doing here? What are you doing here? Father, I just come to you and I thank you for the truth of Elijah's life, for an example of a man who struggled. He struggled because life is hard, because the enemy is real, because the flesh is weak. He struggled because he was a man just like us, with a nature like ours. But you're a God who comes and seeks after those people. You're a God who brings hope to the hopeless, help to the helpless. You don't always give us what we want, but you always give us what we need. I pray right now that you would remind us of what we're doing here. And that would usher us into your presence. In Jesus' name.
Psalm 73. This is the word of the Lord. Truly God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped. For I was envious of the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For they have no pangs until death. Their bodies are fat and sleek. They are not in trouble as others are. They are not stricken like the rest of mankind. Therefore, pride is their necklace. Violence covers them as a garment. Their eyes swell out through fatness. Their hearts overflow with follies. They scoff and speak with malice. Loftily, they threaten oppression. They set their mouths against the heavens, and their tongues struts through the earth. Therefore, his people turn back to them and find no fault in them. And they say, how can God know? Is there any knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the wicked. Always at ease, they increase in riches. All in vain have I kept my heart clean and washed my hands in innocence. For all the day long I have been stricken and rebuked every morning. If I had said, I will speak thus, I would have betrayed the generation of your children. But when I thought how to understand this, it seemed to me a wearisome task until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I discerned their end. Truly, you set them in slippery places. You make them fall to ruin. How they are destroyed in a moment, swept away utterly by terrors. Like a dream when one awakes, O Lord, when you rouse yourself, you despise them as phantoms. And when my soul was embittered, when I was pricked in heart, I was brutish and ignorant. I was like a beast towards you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, and afterward you will receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For behold, those who are far from you shall perish. You put an end to everyone who is unfaithful to you. But for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all your works.
But as for me, it is good to be near God. Guys, Jesus came for us to live such a bigger life than this dried up walk that so many of us kind of are living in. Because the world just sucks the spirit, like the moisture out of us. We live in Arizona, so we get it. But it's true spiritually. Jesus came so that God could do business with you. That's what prayer is. Prayer is God, you are doing business with the Lord. Right? And our God does business at a kingdom level. So as you pray this week, and we go into this the rest of these weeks, but I want to encourage you guys to remember what you're doing. You are praying kingdom glory. And God made that possible by doing business on the cross. The cross was a transaction. For those of you that are old enough to remember the old credit card machines where they would put your card in the machine and they would run the little thing across it and they're going to make that loud noise. That's the cross. Right? What is that card doing? It's saying whatever the debt was that was written on that form is being paid. That's the kind of transaction the cross is. It is that kind of business God does. Right? So whether it's communion, which is the high point of our service, honestly, or it is your private prayer time later today, tomorrow, whenever, remember, you're doing business with the Lord. But here's the beauty. He's done all the work, and your account overflows because of what Jesus did on the cross. Right? As for me, Asaph said, the nearness of God is my good. So as you take the bread, Father, I just thank you, Lord, for your son's body broken for us, for doing business on our behalf, for living the life that we could not live, dying the death that we deserve, that we might live his life as he lives through us. In Jesus' name. And as we take the cup and we remember that what makes it possible for God to not only come near to us but to live in us is that he doesn't see us as sinners anymore. We are blood-bought saints. And he's saying to each and every one of you that are, man, come talk to me. I died that you might talk to me. Let's take the cup together. Thank you, Jesus, that you are our relatable Redeemer. You are not a God that's far off. You are a God who is near. Be near, O God. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Join us in this last song. The question or the statement in the Psalms. Oh, Mrs. Toot is going to share something. Okay, hold up. Just use.
Okay. John 10, 27 and 28 says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give eternal life to them, and they will never perish. And no one will snatch them out of my hand." If there's anyone who needs to pray today, seek out. We are here, and we want to pray with you. He wants to be your God and King. He wants you to hear his voice. He wants to speak to your heart. He loves you so much.
I'm just going to pray. Lord, thank you for hearing us, Lord. Thank you that our voices are not too small for you. Thank you that you are near, that the nearness of God is our good. And we have your nearness because of the cross. So Lord, thank you for what Mrs. Tootin just shared, that not only do you know our voices, but we can know your voice as your sheep. Lord, I pray if there's any who need prayer in here today, that they would seek that out, that they would be bold. Even those of us, Lord, who are feeling strong, Lord, that we would seek out that prayer. Lord, I pray that our hearts would be the heart of David, where in the Psalms he says, "One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple." Lord, I pray that if we could ask for one thing, it would just to be near you, because the nearness of God is our good. In Jesus' name. Would y'all please sing along with us? This is a pretty familiar one, I think.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. For my soul longs and even faints for you. For here my heart is sad. Within your presence, I sing beneath the shadow of your wings. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere, than thousands elsewhere. To seek your beauty. is one day in your courts and thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. My heart and flesh cry out for you, the living God. Your spirit's water to my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. One more time. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Than thousands elsewhere.
Amen. So just a couple quick reminders. D groups start at the end of the month. Please get in one if you are not already. You're going to be hearing about it a lot. Eventually, you'll get sick of hearing it. So how about just hop in one when they start? So we have our 11th annual all-church retreat. I cannot believe it's been 11 times we've done that, but it's amazing. We are so blessed to get to the same location we were at last year. We need everybody there, though. We had our biggest crowd last year, so we do need... We're trying to get the same amount of people as we had last year. So everybody sign up. There is stuff in the lobby for it, the registration forms. But you could also go on the website and get stuff there as well. So next week we are talking, we're in 1 Thessalonians 5. We're talking about the humbling theology of prayer. Our sending passage is 2 Thessalonians 1:11. So we keep on praying for you, asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of his call. May he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. You all are dismissed. Have a great Sunday.